Hello, I'm Mike Palm, sitting in for Richard Ager, and welcome to another edition of New Hampshire Outlook. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and according to statistics, 1 out of 8 women will be developing breast cancer in their lifetime. Now, though there has been a decrease in the mortality rate of patients, the reason why is still very uncertain. We're going to talk a little bit about this on this edition of New Hampshire Outlook. And joining us today are Dr. Diane Palladino, a breast cancer specialist from Exeter Hospital, and Wendy McCool of Elliott, Maine, a breast cancer survivor and founder of the local nonprofit BreastCancerStories.org. Check it out on the web. Thank you, ladies, both for being here. We appreciate your time here on New Hampshire Outlook. Those signature pink ribbons are out there. We see it all over this month, all over New Hampshire, all over New England. We see them from shopping malls to football stadiums. Diane, according to state statistics, breast cancer, the most common cancer among women in New Hampshire. How are we doing? Mortality rates, survival rates. How are we doing so far?
Yeah, it is the most common, Mike, other than skin cancer, of course, and it's the second highest killer of women in the state. But we are doing better. Our survival rates are increasing. Some of that we think is because of early detection, but also because of the newer treatments that we have available for breast cancer.
So people who get diagnosed early or detect a cancer early, the rate of survival is much greater than it was, say, 25 years ago.
That's definitely true.
Yeah. Wendy, you are a breast cancer survivor, and you have taken that story of yours and turned it around into a great positive move by creating this website, BreastCancerStories.org. You're a breast cancer survivor. Tell us a little bit about your story. You were diagnosed in the early part of the decade.
Yeah, I was diagnosed 7 years ago. I was 42. And my mother is a 3-time survivor, and she's been a huge inspiration for me because we were 25 years difference in age when we both went through treatment, and her experience was monumentally different than mine was when it came to support. There were no support groups at the hospital. It took her 10 years to get one started at her hospital because doctors didn't think that people really wanted to talk about it when they really, really did. I think one of the biggest emotional factors that happens when somebody's diagnosed is they feel alone. They feel like they are the only person who is going through that type of a situation, and they're just starving to find somebody else like them, especially somebody who has done well with their treatment, and even connect with them directly if possible, but if nothing else, read their stories and just feel more comfort inside that they're probably going to be okay.
I wanted to ask you, when you first got the diagnosis from your doctor, did you say, like, why me? Why is this happening to me?
I think because of my mother's, my mother having had it 3 times before, I wasn't expecting it to happen. I didn't walk around thinking, well, because she got it, I'm going to get
right.
It. But it wasn't as much of a shock to me because I had lived it through her. The 3 times that she'd gone through it. So was it scary? Was it upsetting? Absolutely. Tenfold, but I felt a little bit more prepared just because I'd been around it before.
You know, you talk about, Diane, the family history. If it's found in your family, should people be aware of that? So should they be concerned about that? Is that a real trend that you will definitely get it, possibly?
Yes, it doesn't mean you're definitely going to get it, but a family history, especially in a first degree relative, that is your mother, your daughter, your sister, increases your risk for the development of breast cancer. So women with family history should be cognizant of that. There are other things, early menarche, first period, and late menopause, a history of male breast cancer in the family increases the risk. Obesity, lack of exercise. Most breast cancers are estrogen loving, and estrogen is stored in fat. So I think that's one of our big problems in this country, the obesity rates.
Yeah, Wendy, you have created an awareness campaign through your website, BreastCancerStories.org. You've taken this negative in your life and you've made it your life. I mean, you were actually working in the corporate field, decided to leave your job and put all your efforts and your talent and your heart, your blood, sweat, and tears into this website to share stories. Tell me about that.
Well, it was so healing for me. When I'm very blessed that I have a large family and a large group of friends, and it was daunting trying to keep them all updated as I went through my treatment. And this was before the whole blogging thing really started to take shape. And I created a website called Bald Wendy and added chapters and photos and tried to make it humorous and light just so they could find more comfort in it. It was an incredible way, very healing for all of us, for me to be able to keep everybody updated in the comfort of my home without getting phone calls and repeating myself over and over again. It was really comforting for them to be able to leave me messages of support through the site. But I started to get messages from people that I didn't know thanking me for sharing my story because it helped them to not feel alone. And it just occurred to me that if my one story helped that many people, how incredible would it be to create an environment where anybody could have that experience, and not just a place to share updates with family, but a way that the stories would be searchable so somebody could find somebody truly going through a similar situation by treatment or by lifestyle situations. Imagine a single mother under the age of 30 who's about to go through a mastectomy or some other type of treatment. She could go on the site and look through the stories and find somebody else like that, read their story, and even connect with them directly through the website.
And that has really taken on a whole international feel. It's worldwide now.
It really is. It's a very intimate environment. It's not like some of the larger social, you know, media outlets that are out there today, but it's very intimate. It's very special. It's powerful.
Yeah.
It's really powerful when you read some of the stories that people have written. And unfortunately, some of the people who have their stories on there are no longer with us, and their family continue to write on it to honor them and memorialize them, which
very
was
nice.
Really very incredible for me as the founder of this to see it take shape like that.
So when you first started writing in your journal, and then the idea to create this website came years later, obviously, what did Bald Wendy talk about in the initial aspects of your diagnosis, and how did your writing change as the years went on?
Initially, it was really all about them. I really devoted my energy and my writings and my photos and things to make my family more comfortable. I kept it very light. I think I didn't share as much honesty with them as I probably should have. I had pictures of my nieces and nephew painting my head like an Easter egg, and and you know, various other head art kind of went on through the course of my treatment. And later on, interestingly enough, when I got finished with my chemo and I started to do radiation and had to go to the cancer center 5 days a week, where at least chemo, you've got a little bit of a respite in between. I really emotionally fell apart during that time because I don't think I'd allowed myself to truly, truly feel the anxiety that I had been feeling because I was working so hard to make sure everybody else was okay and comfortable. And so that was my time to just really sort of fall apart, for lack of a better term, during that time. But
support systems, Diane, obviously are so important when someone is diagnosed with this. What do you recommend to people? This, obviously, a website that Wendy created, is a phenomenal tool that people can log on to and share their emotions and share their feelings. What are your thoughts on support systems?
Well, now I'm going to recommend Wendy's website.
Very good.
But we have support groups at the hospital as well for them. I often give them my email address because it is lonely out there, especially at midnight when they can't sleep. And sometimes it helps them to just shoot off an email that I can get to, not at midnight. There's a great website called breastcancer.org, which was started by Marissa Weiss, who's mm-hmm. a physician in Philadelphia. She's actually a radiation oncologist. And I think it's a tremendous resource for women. And they have chat rooms, and they have monthly presentations that women can log into.
Let's talk about mammograms. Were you regularly getting the mammogram, Wendy?
I was when I was 30. When I was 30, every 2 years until I was 40.
Now, you did that at that young age because your mother had breast cancer?
Yeah, that's what was recommended for me to do.
So, Diane, mammograms. There's been a little bit of a controversy about it, at what age women should get mammograms, if they really do detect cancers, and do they detect early enough. What are your thoughts on this controversy as far as age goes? What do you recommend to women?
Yeah, well, the controversy is a deep one because breast cancer is a disease that has many faces. And so the question is, if you have a little tiny cancer that maybe won't change over a 10-year period, maybe won't hurt the patient for 10 years, does it matter that you find that early?
Do you know that, though, at the time you
diagnose
that?
You don't. That's the problem. Okay. And you can have a little tiny one that acts very aggressively and spreads within 2 years. So the dilemma comes because young women have really dense breast tissue, which shows up white on a mammogram. Cancer shows up white on a mammogram. It's hard to see white on white. older breasts are fatty replaced. They have a lot of black in them. So there's a white cancer sitting in a black background. It's easy to find it. But what happens in the younger women, there are a lot of what we call false positives. So it leads to other mammograms, compression views, ultrasounds, MRIs, maybe biopsies that they didn't need. So that's where the controversy comes in. What it comes down to is, if it were you, would you like to find the cancer early? Most women say yes.
Sure.
But it is an individual decision that should be made between the patient and her physician.
So what is the current recommendation now on age?
The American College of Surgeons, American College of Radiologists all recommend yearly from 40.
From 40 on.
Mm-hmm.
So in the case of Wendy, where she started doing mammograms at 30, that was a good thing because her family had a history of breast cancer.
All right. Wendy was at increased risk. And women like that, or women who are carriers of the breast cancer gene, there are two genes that have been identified, which are responsible for about 5 to 10% of all breast cancers, so they're not very common. But those women should start screening earlier.
Yeah. How far have we come so far, say, like in the last 25 years? You mentioned more breast cancer survivors, the less mortality rate, which is always a good thing. So obviously that has to come from a couple of things. Awareness. People are more aware. Women are more aware. We'll talk about men getting breast cancer as well. I know it's rare, but it is out there. We'll talk about that in a second. But it's awareness, but it's also the improvements of treatments. Talk about how far the medical society, the medical community has gotten as far as tackling this condition.
Yeah, well, the surgical field has actually decreased in its scope in that our surgeries are much less radical than they used to be. When I was a resident, we did the radical mastectomy. And now we do lumpectomies through tiny little incisions. We give radiation treatment. Sometimes you can't even tell that the patient had breast surgery. And we also do what's called partial breast irradiation now, where a balloon catheter is placed in the lumpectomy site and delivers the radiation for 5 days, twice a day, and you're finished. There are intraoperative radiation studies going on where you take the lump out, they bring the machine in, zap the area, and that's it. You're finished with the radiation. But I think the big thing that has changed mortality and increased survival rates is the use of certain chemotherapies and the hormonal therapies like tamoxifen and the aromatase inhibitors. Well, I think they've made the difference.
So it's come a long way, really.
Mm-hmm.
You have to look back at, as you say, how they treated it, say, 25 years ago, the radical ways they treated it.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of radical ways, we've heard stories of people doing some drastic things knowing that their family has a history of breast cancer,
mm-hmm.
like women who are not even diagnosed with cancer yet, but because their mother may have had cancer, go in and say, I want to have a double mastectomy. Well, what are your thoughts on that? It seems to be very radical, I'm assuming it's rare, number one, but it seems to be very radical to live like that.
Well, that's called a prophylactic mastectomy, where you have a mastectomy without having known breast cancer. And it is a recommended treatment in certain women, especially those gene carriers we talked about. Not for all of them, but for some of them, that is a recommended treatment. But some women overestimate their risk for the development of breast cancer, and they get afraid. They don't like being called back for extra views on mammogram.
Sure, yeah.
They hate that time when the mammogram comes around. And rather than living in fear, they rather get rid of their breasts. It certainly is a radical treatment. I try to dissuade them because there are other ways we can follow them. We can follow them with breast MRI if their risk is high enough. There are medications that's called chemo prevention, where you can actually decrease your risk for the development of breast cancer with drugs like tamoxifen and Avista. So it is a radical treatment. I try to talk most women out of it. Some of them demand it.
I was going to say, have you been successful in talking some of these women out of it?
Some of them. I'd say about 50-50.
Because to think that way, as fear affects our thinking, obviously, to come up with that decision, to come to you and say, well, this is what I want done, it seems like they've already made that decision, that it's very difficult to change or sway their minds back the other way.
Yeah, it might take a few visits.
Yeah.
But there are some newer techniques being used for prophylactic mastectomy. There's something called a nipple-sparing mastectomy, where through a tiny incision, the breast tissue is removed, leaving an envelope, leaving the nipple, and then putting an implant in. And the sensation is remains pretty intact, and they have a good looking breast.
Interesting wow. Treatments.
And no more mammograms.
So are you convinced that? I'll ask you both. But are you convinced that mammograms save lives from a medical point of view?
I think in certain circumstances they do. I still think that the earlier you can find a breast cancer, the better chance you have that it hasn't spread.
Yeah. How about you, Wendy? I mean, you recommend to your friends and, you know, your family members that mammograms are the thing to do despite the controversy that's going on?
I think it's one of the things to do. I think
yeah.
I don't think that people should just get mammograms. You have to really pay, in general, in life, you have to pay attention to your body. My daughter is 25. She was 17 when I was diagnosed, and the first words that came out of her were, I'm going to get this too, aren't I? And, you know, we both got a little bit teary about that, and I reminded her that the number one reason that anybody would get breast cancer is because you're a woman. And then there were all kinds of other, you know, issues that, you know, like Diane was mentioning, that come into play. There's so many variables that make up a breast cancer. But I've said to her right from the beginning, just pay attention to your body, and if anything seems out of place or different or feels different, you know, really need to make sure you bring it to the attention of your physician and make sure her physician knows that there is breast cancer in our family. So just be aware, pay attention.
I guess that's part of this whole awareness campaign that we hear about every October. Obviously, we want women and men to sort of be aware of it all year long. But October, of course, is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. The interesting thing that I wanted to mention to you, Diane, is that I read something that says the best prevention is early detection. But is that really prevention? Because even though you're early detection, the cancer is there.
Already there. Yeah.
I'm not trying to be controversial about it, but it's kind of interesting. I don't know how you can get around that.
No, I mean, you're absolutely right. If it's there on the mammogram, it's there. That didn't
right.
prevent it. But there are other ways that I think you can modify your lifestyle that might help decrease your risk. And those things are a low-fat diet, exercise, alcohol avoidance, not to, you know, completely avoid it, but not a lot of alcohol. Even two drinks a day supposedly increases the risk for breast
really?
Cancer.
Wow.
And as Wendy said, you know, paying attention to your body.
Yeah.
I know even self-breast exam is now poo-pooed by some organizations, but I think if you know what's going on in your body, that's what's important.
So be aware.
Well, I found mine through a self breast exam.
Yeah.
So not to say the mammogram that I was probably going to get within the next year wouldn't have found it, but at least I found
maybe
it.
Maybe not if you
yeah.
had dense breasts.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I think that there are so many things we can't control and that we don't know why this cancer occurred. I have two sisters with breast cancer. They're identical twins. And I participated in a study from the National Cancer Institute called the Sister Study. They interview sisters of breast cancer survivors and ask you all kinds of questions about what life was like growing up. Things like, did you live near a chicken farm or a fertilizer plant? How many hot dogs did you have a month? When I was a kid, we lived in New Jersey. We'd go to the shore in the summer and run after the mosquito truck as he spewed his DDT out. Maybe that's why my sisters have breast cancer. Those are things we don't know about, we can't control, but some of our own lifestyle things we need to take responsibility for.
So many variables, as you say, and who knows how or when they will ever be able to focus in and say, well, this is why mm-hmm. women and men get it. It seems like there's just so many variables out there.
There are, and hopefully this study will shed some light on it.
Yeah. Wendy, with the website breastcancerstories.org, what, out of all the stories that you've read or you've seen on the website that people have participated on this website, is there any one or two stories that have sort of really affected you or impacted you in a powerful way?
Yeah, Shannon Morin, who was being treated at the Elliott Hospital in Manchester, had her story on the website, and she, delightful young woman, she was diagnosed when she was 27 and got well, and then about a year later was re-diagnosed, and she passed away. I think she lost her battle within 6 months of that diagnosis. It just kind of, you know, took over her body. But she was such a sweetheart, and everybody loved her at the hospital. She was adorable. She was funny. She had over 100 chapters on the website, great photos, just such a spirited life she lived in such a, you know, taken at such a young age. And hers was the first story that continued after she passed away, where people would add things, you know, and memorialize her. And I think she must have had 200 to 300 guest book entries after after she passed away. And her mom asked me to speak at her funeral, which I did with honor. So she and I talk about her and think about her all the time. So she definitely had a big impact, and her story is still there, and it's still touching people. And her story, it just wasn't shared with her family. Other patients were leaving messages for her too, while she was living, and even after she passed, just, you know, thanking her for her inspiration. And, you know, it's a very powerful and touching.
Oh, she seemed like
website.
A wonderful woman.
Very much so.
And had a lot to say and a lot to share.
She did. She did.
Now you're taking your website and sort of redeveloping with another website as well, and it's mybreastcancersupport.org, correct?
Right.
Talk a little bit about that and what your plan is for this website and what you're planning to do with some of the area hospitals in New Hampshire and Maine.
Sure. Breast Cancer Stories is a great resource for, again, for people to share stories and stay connected. The world of blogging has really taken off, and it's hard for us little local nonprofits to keep up sometimes. So what we that's staying in place. People are, I had three people sign up today to use it. People are finding it and they're using it, but we're starting this new program, which is all community-based, called My Breast Cancer Support, and we're working with Exeter, Andover, Rochester, Portsmouth, York, and York County Cancer Centers, and providing a lot of different support tools for their patients, travel scholarships to educational conferences, a non-medical grant program that will just help with quality of life, whether it's sending somebody away for a weekend. We haven't even launched the program yet, and I was able to get tickets to Wicked in Boston for a woman that is not doing very well at one of the local hospitals, and it was her last wish. So we were able to get her tickets and a limousine to go with her family. So that was things like that, just to help people to feel better. It's really about emotional wellness and health. We are going to have volunteers willing to do with help with household needs, whether it's yard work or cleaning out a garden, you know, plowing, house cleaning, things like that. Just those are cumbersome issues when somebody's going through treatment. They need to focus on health. And if we can just come up with some other ways to relieve some of that pressure of the other day-to-day issues that face them and just make their lives better. That's what we're aiming to do.
Well, more power to you. It's a wonderful thing you're doing. You've taken your story and you've taken your life and sort of, like I said, created this whole movement of support, which is really wonderful.
It's important.
It's very important. I want to just mention there is male breast cancer as well, correct?
Yes.
We know it's rare. I mean, what kind of percentages are we talking about as
Probably
far as?
Probably 1% of all breast cancer occurs in males. And more commonly is something called gynecomastia, which is swelling of the male breast that we see in older men as their hormone levels drop. But if they felt a lump, it would be a hard lump, kind of like a marble, outside where the nipple areola complex is. That should be a red flag. The other, and men can get mammograms and ultrasounds.
I didn't realize that, they can.
Yeah. And the other thing about male breast cancer is that's a red flag that that family might be a carrier of the BRCA1 or 2 gene, because one of the things about those gene carriers is that there's often male breast cancer in the family.
Right. And are the treatments the same?
Usually mastectomy is the treatment.
For males as
for
well?
For males as well, yeah. And lymph nodes and sometimes chemotherapy.
Wow. Do you think that we are the generation, this generation? I mean, some people say that, well, if you live long enough, cancer will get you one way or another, if you live long enough. Well, the idea is to have a healthy, productive life, you know, so someone in their 30s or 40s, and we've heard of people even in their 20s getting breast cancer. Do you sense that this is the generation that could stop this disease, breast cancer? Do you sense that we've come this far?
Well, the National Breast Cancer Coalition feels that if we can put someone on the moon, we can stop breast cancer.
Yeah. Well, let's hope we can. Obviously, we hope that people are aware of it. And I feel that the education and awareness is out there for people to grasp mm-hmm. a hold of it and take it all in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's certainly plenty of resources.
Yeah. Do you feel that way, Wendy, that it's out there?
Absolutely. It's, you know, and again, I go back to my mother's story. There was really nothing for her. She went in to the doctors by herself. My father didn't even go with her. They told her she had breast cancer. The nurses wouldn't even make eye contact with her. They gave her an appointment card for the next week and sent her home. And she sat out in the parking lot and just sobbed. It's kind of interesting what Diane was talking about too. There's so many different variables about breast cancer. Just because you get breast cancer doesn't mean you're gonna die. Right. But back then, I think everybody thought you were gonna die.
Yeah, so it's changed a great deal.
It has changed a great deal. We still have a ways to go, but there's a lot of awareness, there's a lot more support resources and a lot more education and obviously a lot of great medical breakthroughs.
All right, we'll have to make that the last word. Wendy McCool, thank you so much. BreastCancerStories.org.
You're welcome.
And Dr. Diane Palladino from Exeter Hospital. Thank you for your insight. I do appreciate it. Well, that's all the time we have today on this edition of New Hampshire Outlook. We thank you for watching. Thanks again to our guests. I'm Mike Pomp. I will see you next time right here on New Hampshire Outlook.